Welcome to this week's Space Showtime on ESN, your Earth Station Network. This program is brought to you by corporate sponsors Luxor North America, STV and OnSat Magazines, and Caltronics Incorporated. Space Showtime is a co-production of your Satellite Industry Trade Association, SPACE, and Nova Video Productions, which produced Satellite Showtime. So it's a combination of both shows. This week's show is coming to you from Wisconsin, and next week's program will come live from Washington, D.C., and you can look forward to that. There will be a live call-in segment. Even when the show is in Wisconsin, however, we do go to Washington for an industry information update. I'll now turn it over to Joe Boyle of SPACE for that.
Good evening from Washington, D.C. This is Joe Boyle.
And Robin Neidert. Leading off this week's events in Washington, D.C. is the announcement of TCI, the nation's largest cable company, that it has negotiated agreements to sell cable programming to home satellite dish users. Joe, can you give us the details to date on TCI's announcement?
Sure, Robin. The announcement was made last week by Senior Vice President John Tse at a meeting of cable operators in Anaheim, California at the cable industry's Western Show. The deal is essentially non-exclusive, meaning that program networks will be free to sign with other companies that will be able to offer programming to satellite Earth Station owners. TCI said the package will include CBN Cable, Cable News Network, Cable News Network's Headline News, Lifetime, MTV, Nickelodeon, VH1, Arts and Entertainment, and Black Entertainment Network. The pay movie TV networks included in the package our home box office, Cinemax, Showtime, the Movie Channel, Disney Channel. All of the services have agreed to scramble their signals using the MACOM Video Cipher 2 and MACOM's DBS Control Center. TCI said it would lease decoders for $6 to $8 a month to Earth Station owners. TCI also said it plans to, quote, sign these deals with reputable and financially sound, end quote, TVRO dealers to act as sales agents on a commission basis, noting in particular that reputable TVRO dealers are the best dealers in TCI's view. TCI's basic package will be retailed for $6 a month. Consumers will be offered their first pay service at $10 a month and each additional pay for $6.50 a month. TCI's proposed plan to distribute programming to Earth Station owners inside and outside of their franchised areas falls short of SPACE's own efforts to ensure that competition exists everywhere. SPACE will not be satisfied until other companies are granted similar rights to sell program packages and decoders. SPACE said again that it wants to ensure that the package is available everywhere.
We will have more on that TCI story next week. On the negative advertising front, SPACE will begin a program to assist dealers with this problem, which is growing throughout the nation. Can you give us the details on that, Joe?
Sure, Robin. Because of this negative advertising and anti-satellite Earth Station advertising appearing in local newspapers, SPACE will begin sending its members local ad slicks and a public relations press package to respond to the negative advertising. We urge all members to reprint the press releases onto your own company letterhead or stationery and mail the releases directly to your local newspaper or radio or TV station. We also recommend that dealers follow up with a phone call to either the editor of the local publication or the reporter covering our industry. The ad slick developed by SPACE promotes the benefits of earning a home Earth station, namely that it offers choice, while emphasizing that most programming will be available whether or not it's scrambled. The important message to communicate here is that the skies will not go dark.
On the Future Fund front, SPACE urges all manufacturers to order their decals now. The decals will be available in January. Give the SPACE office a call and make sure that you've got your Future Fund decals on hand for the January kickoff.
I think at this point, 28 companies have announced their intentions to become involved. And as we've mentioned earlier, the funds will be earmarked to three different items. First of all, we're going to be earmarking the funds for legislative and legal areas, earmarked toward consumer awareness programs, and finally for the establishment of a town hall network. which is our industry's answer to the cable industry's C-SPAN.
We hope that manufacturers will take advantage of this opportunity because the industry needs to establish the Future Fund now. More from Washington, D.C. this week, EIA, the Electronic Industries Association, has announced that it will be forming a satellite Earth station division. And we have got a response to that, I'm sure, Joe.
Okay. On this announcement, Space is, one, first of all, not surprised by the announcement by the Consumer Electronics Group of the EIA, given the reputation for their size and their expansion into other industries in the past. However, Space strongly doubts that EIA would involve itself in some of the thornier issues affecting the satellite Earth station, such as scrambling and zoning, and that EIA would not become involved in fighting those battles. Space believes that EIA would limit its activities to sales and marketing areas such as their local trade shows.
Yes, so we urge you, if you're considering joining the EIA, to take a few minutes to talk to Chuck Hewitt or Rick Brown or Taylor Howard about EIA's past activities and about what we can expect them to do for the Earth station industry.
In order to encourage consumers to join Space's consumer division, we will begin sending out to our dealers applications over the next week. These applications will be used to sign up new consumer members. The forms will be mailed out to dealers this week. Our dealers are urged to encourage their consumers to sign up now. Membership is free. Membership entitles consumers to receive legislative and zoning updates. Now, a zoning update from Robin.
Thank you, Joe. We have got some good news on the zoning front in Athens, Ohio. City Council had proposed a very restrictive zoning ordinance for a second time. When the hearing was held open to the public, a number of satellite Earth station owners and dealers took the opportunity to come and tell the County Council exactly what they thought of the ordinance. In fact, Space and Brown and Finn had an opportunity to write every member of the County Council and to give them the details on the FCC's proposed guidelines on zoning. We are very happy to report that the County Council gave due consideration to the material Space sent it, and the restrictive ordinance was defeated recently. Also, in Sea Island, New Jersey, a number of Space dealers, Anna Vasali and her husband Bill, Joe Montora, have taken the opportunity to educate the Sea Island City Council concerning a restrictive ordinance that is proposed there. In fact, for the past several months, Sea Island has had a ban on the installation of home satellite dishes. Space, through its efforts with Brown and Finn, has managed to have the ban removed, and the restrictive zoning ordinance is up for vote before the City Council tomorrow. We have provided considerable information to all members of the Council and the Mayor, and we are hoping for a favorable outcome in Athens. We're also happy to report that the newest congressman, who is a supporter of H.R. 1840, is Congressman Lee Hamilton from Indiana. And we believe that the reason, a good part of the reason he became a co-sponsor, were the efforts of dealers throughout the state of Indiana, in particular Mary Lou Hines of H&H Electronics. The dealers got together and held a public meeting on scrambling, which was attended by over 400 people from the local public around the Indiana area. They came to hear what scrambling was all about and were urged to write to their congressman, which they did. Several weeks later, Congressman Hamilton became a co-sponsor of H.R. 1840. I think that's a pretty good indication of what kind of response constituent letters, constituent calls to Congress can have, Joe.
No question. I guess this is very important, Robin, and we will continue to emphasize this over the next coming weeks as our shows continue, that we have to get out there and develop this grassroots lobbying effort.
Yes.
And continue this overall effort.
And a public meeting is a very good idea. I must admit that Mary Lou reported she was very surprised at the number of people from the public who wanted to know about scrambling, who wanted to know the facts. She read the letter that President Reagan sent to the industry on Satellite Earth Station Day. She showed clips of the Satellite Earth Station Day tape. She gave out information, and she also gave out a roster for people to sign up. These are members of the public to sign up to appoint Space, their representative, in negotiating for viewing rights for the home satellite Earth station industry. And as a result of their efforts, Congress has responded. Now, that is a testimony to the fact that you can make a difference out there, especially if dealers in a certain area of the country get together and cooperate in getting the word out to the members of the public.
Dealers who need assistance on developing these programs will have the PR guides, which, as we mentioned earlier, will be sent out to use as a reference. And I think that it's very important that you pay attention to these guidelines when we send them to you.
And if you're interested in holding a similar public meeting, please contact Space, contact Brown and Finn. We'd be glad to help and provide you with materials so that you can get the word on scrambling out to the public.
At this point now, we're getting ready to close this session. We'll be meeting same time next week. We'll have an in-depth analysis on these and other reports.
We look forward to seeing you then.
From Washington, D.C., I'm Joe Boyle.
And Robin Neidert.
Thank you, Joe. Mike Gustafson's latest product review is coming up on Space Showtime, along with a news update on a new Wisconsin group. Stay tuned.
The Luxor Luxury Las Vegas Tour Competition is underway. Five top Luxor dealers and their guests are eligible to enjoy the great four-day, three-night luxury stay in Las Vegas, the nation's entertainment capital. The luxury stay is at Caesars Palace and includes all accommodations, a delicious dinner, cocktail show, champagne breakfast, helicopter, scenic tour over the beautiful Grand Canyon, and then Hoover Dam and much more. Value of this entire luxury stay in Las Vegas is more than $2,000 per couple, and it can be yours. Save those Luxor bonus coupons and follow directions. They'll lead you to this great Luxor Luxury Las Vegas tour.
With more than 100 channels available on your home satellite system, a good programming guide is an absolute necessity. OnSat packs more viewing information in its 88-page weekly format than any other program guide, including daily primetime highlights in a handy grid format, plus complete listings in an easy-to-read rolling log. Daily sports listings by category. The largest alphabetical movie description of any satellite guide. A complete listing of satellite locations and each transponder and much, much more. All of this can be yours for only $45 per year. That's less than $1 per week. We're so sure you'll like OnSat that we would like to send you a free sample copy. Pick up the telephone and call toll-free now for your free copy of OnSat. Call 1-800-438-2020. That's 1-800-438-2020.
A repeat telecast of Space Showtime can be seen every Wednesday at 12 noon Eastern on SpaceNet 1, Channel 19. That's in addition to our Tuesday evening program, which comes at 9 o'clock Eastern Time, also on SpaceNet 1, Channel 19. Satellite Earth Station Day was 6 whole weeks ago in Washington, D.C., but the spirit of that event lives on. Inspired by Satellite Earth Station Day, these Wisconsinites have formed their own group.
And we wanted to try to get the dealers to unite and develop some kind of co-op advertising campaign that we can come out and make people a little more aware of the other side of the story to scrambling. You know, what's up there now, what's not looking at scrambling, radio services, off satellite, some of the other things that have to do with satellite television that the cable operators don't seem to be reporting, which is no surprise.
What you are seeing here is the group's second meeting. How manufacturers, dealers, and distributors came to the state's capital despite the threat of bad weather, that is, sleet and snow. They gathered to talk about scrambling, legislation, and to talk about why organizing their group is so important in the light of the cable threat. Cable is a well-organized and well-funded industry.
What we have to do, and what's more important, is create one solid, unified body. Space has provided some information, I know, to Joel here already. I encourage every one of you who are not members of Space to join Space today. It's the best investment you can make.
Dealer Frank Wilkie of Invacom continued, referring to his visit in Washington with Senator William Proxmire.
the number of dishes in this state, the amount of dishes produced in this state. You know, we're the dairy capital, but we may become the dish capital. How many jobs are involved in this state? Those numbers surprised him. But the most important thing that I think that surprised him is he turned to his legislative aide and said, "How's the mail running?" And his aide said, "Heavy." And he said, "Against?" And he said, "No, for." So people out there have been doing the job getting to the congressmen and the senators.
John Call of Calltronics mentioned that a lot of programmers' losses come from within the cable industry. And home satellite viewers, he says, are getting a bum rap.
15% to 20% of people that take cable, a cable franchisee, underreports. And there's much more theft by cable operators themselves on the signal than the million and a half systems that are out there. So that's a point that, you know, they would derive a hell of a lot more money if they were collecting 100% of what they should be.
What can the satellite industry do when a programmer announces it's going to scramble? Well, dealer Frank Wilkie told about an ally we can turn to.
And how I look at it is the free enterprise system is alive and well, and all those advertisers on ESPN from Budweiser on down are not going to be happy suddenly one day when their market share of advertising based on Nielsen readings drops 8 million people in one day, that suddenly who have been watching their commercials can no longer see those commercials. Having been in the printing and publishing background, they're going to be drastically concerned on their rates that they're going to be charged by ESPN for advertising. They're going to want their rates reduced because their market share of advertising reduced. We've completely forgot about what the advertiser can do for us on those advertiser support stations. He's a tremendous power on our side.
A total of 38 determined and enthusiastic people came to the home satellite meeting. They didn't let even a wind chill factor of zero get in their way. They plan to publicize the benefits of satellite TV, to recruit more members, and to present a unified front in the battle for equal access and fair prices. Space Showtime will continue with Pat Porter, Bob Cooper, and Mike Gustafson.
Introducing the Calltronics Trans-10X. With the latest in antenna technology, this beautifully designed and crafted 10-foot dish is strong and accurate. Calltronics antenna test results are based on the use of chaparral feed horns, recommended for all Calltronics antennas. The Trans-10X features a thermoset black finish and maximum strength ribs, hub, and rim. Experience the quality yourself at a price you won't believe. The Trans-10X lives up to the Calltronics tradition of quality.
Want to know more about satellite TV? Then go to the source for product reviews and how-tos. We're on the road and out in space and sometimes in very cold places with features and technical reports. It's all in satellite TV. That's only $19.95 for 12 big issues of STV Magazine. Call now, 1-800-438-2020, and get this LCD calendar clock free with your subscription. That's 12 big issues of STV Magazine and the clock for only $19.95. The number again is 1-800-438-2020. 1-800-438-2020. Call now.
Keep those vital satellite components trouble-free with QuickPro. Protect your LNA motor and actuator from birds and insects. Its flow-through air vents reduce LNA temperature and control moisture. A high-quality, soft neoprene cover that works in extreme cold and heat and has the highest infrared, ozone, and ultraviolet ratings. QuickPro means long life and great protection. To order, call 1-800-821-7384. In Ohio and outside the U.S., call 419-289-2228.
Mike Gustafson is technical editor for STV and Satellite Retailer magazines. He also does a tech tip segment for us on Space Showtime. Tonight, he reviews an industry newcomer.
And good evening again. Welcome. Tonight, we're going to be talking about the Kenwood satellite receiver, but before we get started on that review, let me read you yet another letter we received. This one comes from Dick Collins, a United Airlines captain and who is now retired. And he thanks me for doing this particular program and talks about a mutual friend of ours, Lou Dorn, who loaned him a Cook receiver and to give to his daughter. And he's running into a little bit of a problem with the receiver, and he's asked some information on the gain desired minimum and maximum limits for the LNA to down conversion for the receiver to work best. Well, Captain Collins, let me suggest that in most of the systems we have today, anything above 40 dB gain in the LNA with no more than a 12 to 15 foot run between cable length, I should say, between the low noise amplifier and the down converter is correct and adequate. And then as long as the cable length between, say, the down converter and the receiver is kept to a minimum, you should have no problems worrying about the translation gain between the dish and the receiver inside. Obviously, if you're using a block system, the higher block frequencies, and you're running extremely long lengths in cable, you do have to be concerned about the cable length. And you'll have to use better coaxial cable with lower losses if you have, say, a 950 to 1450 block system. But if you're using a 70 megahertz IF, you could anticipate running up to 500 feet and not having a problem with the kind of LNA gains that I've described. This is true of anything from a 6-foot through a 12-foot dish. Just be concerned if your down converter is separated from your receiver by more than, say, 200 feet, you might have to look into that. But if you had a 30 dB gain LNA, which I don't believe they're selling on the market anymore, you could have a problem. Okay, I hope that answers your questions, and thank you very much for the letter. So let's get on with the product review today. That's of the Kenwood satellite receiver. It's called the KSR-1000, which is a receiver, and the companion drive is the KSP-1000. Now, Kenwood has an interesting history. Most of you, I'm sure, are aware of the fact that Kenwood makes audio equipment. Well, they have now made video equipment, and so they've made this particular receiver to match the audio equipment. The receiver is a full-function receiver. It has every bell and whistle you could ever imagine. There's a couple things left out, which I'll get to in a minute, but let's talk about the receiver to begin with. Starting on the left-hand side, we have our power switch, polarization skew, which you only have to use once, and I'll explain that. Parental lockout controls, scan controls, and then a whole series, this whole line here, is audio programming. Now, let me spend a moment on this audio section. The receiver, as it comes, has a ROM, read-only memory, permanently installed in it with pre-programmed information about all the different audio frequencies that are available out there for each channel. You also, there are 14 of those channels, I believe, that are pre-programmed, and then there are 14 other RAM programmable audio channels that you can program into, special channels. So you have this receiver coming to you pre-programmed for all the different stereo channels that are currently out there. Obviously, when the new service comes in, it's not going to be in it, and that's why the extra RAM memories are available. The next series of buttons along the bottom are for the drive. They select the SATCOM 4, SATCOM 3, SAT, whatever you push for the name and then the number, and it goes out and it moves the drive. Now, this display is rather unique. I think this is the first time I've seen this kind of a display. This is called a gas discharge display. On the left-hand side is the signal strength. The middle number here is satellite number. Then we have transponder number. Now, currently, you see a blinking light, possibly. That blinking light says that I have locked out, parentally locked out, this particular channel, transponder 12, SATCOM 4. I wonder why. Okay, moving along, we have the audio section. We have multiplex, matrix, and discrete stereo, wide and narrow band audio bandpass, also the polarization format, whether it's vertical or horizontal, then the audio frequency, and then which of the audio channels we've programmed into it. The main channel tuning is handled by a very large knob. Now, I would like you to hear this. This is kind of a nice little feature. This is what I call a feather touch knob, in that it's not physically connected to anything. It's an optical type knob. There's a little disc behind this knob, and there are light. There's a little light shining through it, and as I rotate it, the light breaks different through the holes, and it tells it to change channels. So let's go to 12. Now I'm going to let you listen to this beep. Every time you change channel, you get this beep. It's a very interesting little process. I especially like it. It's programmable. As you can see, we're going from SATCOM 4 transponder 12 with 6.8. Now we'll go to 11, and that selects a different audio channel, and you can hear the audio start up. That's the channel selection process right there. In order to change audio channels, we have the tuning controls. We can do that from there. All right, now I'd like to discuss a little bit about the remote control. This comes with the remote control. It's a full-function receiver, so it's got to have one of these little devils. The top part of the remote handles the satellite selection, satellites from SATCOM 1 all the way up through. They have Telstar, Galaxy, Westar, SpaceNet, and then others A, B, and C. So you can essentially program just about any satellite you'd want into it. Channel selection, audio selection are built into it. What is missing off this remote, which is one of the things that I dinged it for when I did the product review. And by the way, this particular product review will be appearing in the November issue of Satellite Retailer, was that there is not an audio level control built into the remote control at all. And I think that's a very important feature. There is an audio level control for the stereo that's on the front panel, which is settable, but not on the remote control. Okay. That, I think, talks a little bit about the remote well enough there. Now let's talk about the drive. The drive can operate without the receiver, but it's designed to go with the receiver. To that extent, there is an audio, what I'll call a data cable back here, which connects, that's all it connects, the receiver and the power drive together. And with that, you're able to control the power drive from the receiver, or if you want, you can program and operate from the power drive. One note of caution, if you operate from the power drive, though, the polarization sequences are lost on the receiver. As this receiver sets, you can program in the skew, polarization skew, and format reversal for all the satellites, so you never have to deal with that again. That's a nice feature. And when you operate the whole system from the receiver, then the polarization operation is correct. But if you operate from the power drive, the polarization is not correct, and you could get into a little bit of a problem. But just be aware of that little feature. When you select, let me just go ahead and select, let's go to SATCOM 4. We're already on it, so it's not going to let me do that. Let's try for Westar 4. So we have Westar 4. And it should take off and go do its thing. We don't have it hooked up right at the moment. It's on a fixed antenna, so you won't see it really do anything. I just wanted to show you the functional of the display and how it looks. It comes with a low noise block down converter, 85 degree K, using the 950 to 1450 megahertz IF band. The only thing about the receiver, other than the fact there isn't a level control on the remote control, audio level control, is that it's not synthesized. That, I think, is a major failing of this particular receiver. It should have been synthesized. A receiver with all these features to be synthesized would have been, I think, a very simple thing to do. Technically, it's not simple, but I believe for all that it does, to not have that is kind of unfortunate. So those are the only two feature things I found about it that were, if you will, a negative. The actuator that comes with it is a hammer blow actuator, which is an excellent actuator. Why I like the hammer blow and some of the others that are now coming along is that the hammer blow does include limit switches that are settable, so that once we set our arc properly, we can set the limit switches and we don't have to worry about the drive running away with itself and hurting something, itself mostly, or the antenna. Okay, let's look at the data sheet now that we have up on the board, plus our little photographs. Let's take a look at that. Now we have I'm trying some new things here. We have a new data sheet that maybe will make it a little bit clearer for you to see. And while you're taking a look at that data sheet, I'll sort of describe some of the points that I think were important here. It has a excellent signal-to-noise ratio of 41 dB, which is good, so it got a good on that. Excellent picture quality. Frequency response was just a little low. It fell off about 3 dB at 4.2 MHz, which is no big deal, but a little further down than I'd like. The bandwidth of the receiver is 27 megahertz, which is good. And the video threshold was about 7.5 dB, which is very, very good. And we'll talk about the IF noise bandwidth a little bit later, trying to explain why that's important. Audio distortion was in the 0.93 percentile region. Signal noise ratio at 50 dB, and the audio bandpass went from 30 hertz to 17 kilohertz. The frequency stability of the block was excellent, less than 500 kilohertz drift for the whole system. Now, the final overall score, I think, bears a little discussion. You'll see 87.5%, and it got a good. It missed dropping into the excellent by 1.5%. If it had had a remote control with a level adjust on it or had been synthesized, it would have dropped into excellent. I have yet to have a receiver test excellent, and this came as close as any of them. In fact, 87.5 is the highest percentage I've had any receiver test at in any of the STV product reviews that I've done. So it missed it just barely, but it almost made it. The frequent video response shown in these photos, once again, these are off-the-air photos. Typically, I use Galaxy One as my satellite for taking the photos. You can see that the patterns are very square. The bar pulse bar ratio is quite good. Everything looks very, very good. This is an excellent photos. And you can actually see here on the photo of the frequency response how it falls off. We're going to compare this burst frequency. This is what they call a multi-burst pattern. And we start out at 0.5 megahertz and go all the way to 4.2 megahertz. And you can see how it rolls off slightly. Okay, now I wanted to talk a little bit about bandwidth, audio bandwidth versus threshold. People get confused about that. And let me just draw a little picture up here of what a transmitted signal might look like. And you'll have to ride with me a little bit about with my artistry, but that's the best I can do. This is the audio subcarrier, usually 6.8 megahertz away. And it's symmetrical, one on each side. And all the video operates in this region. And this is all the video patterns right in here. Now, this total transmitted information rate, as it's transmitted from the satellite, is 31.6 megahertz. That means that if we wanted to contain all of the transmitted information as it came from the satellite, we'd have to have a bandwidth of at least 32 megahertz. Here that if we had a 32 megahertz bandwidth, we would have to have a very large antenna, and then typically in the neighborhood of a 5 meter dish. So we have to make a trade-off in the home satellite system type of environment. And what we do is we make a trade-off. We start cutting out parts of the video and the audio, and we start reducing this down to, in this case, 27 megahertz is what it is. It's given up essentially 5 megahertz. You won't notice that. That's a good trade-off. That's a good number. But some receivers you might find in the 20 region megahertz. Well, at 20 megahertz, we're severely cutting into the audio, and that's why sometimes you'll notice on a receiver that when a red color or a blue color comes up on it, you'll hear in the audio a buzz. And that's caused by the fact that the bandpass of the receiver is such that it's cutting off part of the audio, and when the video information deviates out in this region, we lose it. And it's essentially noise that you're hearing. So we have to reduce the IF bandpass of the receivers in order to use 12-foot, 10-foot, 8-foot, 6-foot dishes. Because while the information rate is at 31.6 megahertz, our noise is also that wide. So we reduce the bandpass a little bit in order to reduce the noise, but we don't cut out enough video information to really cause any particular problems with the color quality of the receiver. In my opinion, and it's one person's opinion, when you get below 22 megahertz of bandpass, you really have gone too far. I like to see anything in the region of 25 to 27 as a nice optimum bandpass. It's a good trade-off. That means that when we talk about a 27 megahertz bandpass, and then a very good threshold, a low threshold, less than 8, they've done their homework. I can take a lot of these receivers in the market and reduce their bandpass down to 18 or 20, and I can get the threshold to drop into the low 7s as well. But the video quality is not as good. To have a 27 megahertz wide IF and then get a threshold below 8 is good. Kenwood has done their homework on this. Okay, I think that pretty much brings us to the end of this product review. It's the Kenwood KSR-1000 receiver with the KSP-1000 power drive. It's a stylish-looking little receiver. It tested the highest of any receiver we've tested in the STV laboratories since I started doing it about 3 years ago. And the only real negative I can say, I wish it was synthesized. So I think that'll do it for the time being. Thanks a lot. Good evening. See you next time.
If you have any comments or suggestions for Mike, you can write to him at Post Office Box 20700, San Jose, California, 95160. Coop's TVRO Profile is next on Space Showtime. Stay with us.
I'm Joe Kelsch with an announcement for you dealers out there. Would you like a TV commercial produced for you at a cut rate? If so, you can join the Space Dealer Consumer Awareness Program. The purpose is to drive potential Earth Station owners to your store for a demonstration of your equipment. The program will be supported with national and local advertising with your store name listed in all ads. You'll receive a complete dealer kit with point-of-purchase material. Make checks payable to Space Sweepstakes, Space Sweepstakes, and mail to Space at 300 North Washington Street, Alexandria, Virginia, 22314. The phone number for Space is 703-549-6990. If you have any questions, you can also call Dave Vengus at the Litchfield Group. His number is 212-598-0600. You can charge it to your Visa, MasterCharge, or American Express card. The cost is $300 plus $50 per store if you want the TV spot produced for you that you can tag on with your store's name. Radio spots available too. This is the Space Dealer Consumer Awareness Program. If you have questions, you can call Space or Dave Vengus at the numbers listed on the screen.
Satellite TV Preview is the best thing next to your satellite dish. With all those programs now at your fingertips, you won't want to miss a thing. Satellite Preview lists over 100 transponders in an easy-to-read weekly grid schedule. It has a daily list of movies, specials, and sports, plus a list of sports by event. Call and subscribe now for only $47 for 52 issues and save $31 off the newsstand price. Or call for a free sample copy. Dealers, we also have a special offer for you. Call 800-826-0735. Visa and MasterCard accepted. Satellite TV Preview, the best thing next to television.
Now on with Space Showtime and Bob Cooper.
One transistor, one diode, and about four other parts. And of course, you don't need to clamp anything. Yeah. So this becomes quite a bit simpler in KU. Plus the fact, of course, you have a stronger signal. So you combine this with your rolled up cone of aluminum. That's what the future has. Everybody's going to be able to afford one, all over the world, provided the signal's there.
His name is Keith Anderson. And he has been changing the way America and the world receives television for more than 30 years now. Keith Anderson is the elder member of the Anderson clan out of Rapid City, South Dakota. And those are the Anderson Scientific Andersons, of course.
You know, if you didn't have anything else to watch, and all you could afford was a $5 antenna, you can buy yourself a 4-foot square piece of aluminum and that's what you would watch. with a regular receiver, that's the very best you would do. With the ability to optimize the IF for the pitcher, that's how you would do.
Keith Anderson appears to be driven, perhaps even possessed, by bringing down the cost of satellite TV reception. He may have done more to lower TVRO system costs than any other single person in the industry today, worldwide.
So I've had to go two directions now. I continue on my course of trying to build a satellite system that everyone can afford. I'd like to see the dish prices reduced, and the LNA prices have done their own thing, of course, but my objective is to get it down to where it's a worldwide thing, where it benefits the people who aren't buying them as a rich man's toy. Again, my family and operating the manufacturing business, they're more aware of marketing as it is today in this country, where it is somewhat of a toy. And so they have in turn made it a little more complex, and I've had to assist with that. While I continue to make it less and less complex, to where we have it down now, to where with excellent pitchers you can put it in your pocket.
Of course, anyone can build cheaply. Madman Earl Muntz, for example, discovered how cheaply television sets could be built in the 50s. His technique became legendary. He directed his engineers to start clipping parts out of existing designs in TV receivers, parts like resistors and capacitors. Keep that up, he said, until the TV set stops working. And then put back the last one you clipped out, and that freezes the design. Well, Keith Anderson is driven by a different master.
I made it cheap and simple. You know, I discovered that there was a very stable oscillator, much more stable than most people realize, was available out of about three components that have less than $3 cost now if you buy them in any sort of volume. And that stable oscillator that would run at the frequency difference between the microwave frequencies and the UHF band, which we had chosen because it was already all sorts of components were already available at those frequencies, especially the tuner, led me to be able to decrease the cost of block conversion by an order of several magnitudes. I don't want to take credit for block conversion, just cheap block conversion.
Anderson's first satellite receiver in 1981 cost him $115 to build. That was $15 in parts, plus $99.95 for a Hitachi black and white television set. Keith knew he was onto something significant.
My first really good operational satellite receiver was a Hitachi TV set with a modification of the using the tuner. It kind of came together. I discovered that with one transistor I could convert 4 gigahertz down to the UHF band. And so then the first receiver, which the simplest receiver approach I could take at that time was just to use all the existing circuitry, even the power supply and the tuner, out of an electronically tuned Hitachi television set. And all I really added to that, I took the IF filter out to increase the bandwidth, because that was the only real tuning it had in its IF. And then I added an extremely simple detector, which consisted of 4 diodes and a couple tank circuits. And we got limiting free because I disabled the automatic gain control in the Hitachi's IF. So it produced color pictures.
Anderson has innovated several important technology breakthroughs in TVRO receiver design, breakthroughs which have helped him bring the cost of a TVRO receiver way down. Now, one involving a change he created in the TVRO receiver's video detector circuit was recently granted a patent. Those who have lifted this circuit trick from the Anderson receivers will shortly be hearing from Anderson attorneys concerning patent infringement.
The beauty of that chip is, as a quadrature chip, it with one simple tuned circuit, You do obtain your quadrature detection, but pin 2 and pin 12 exactly what it was on it. And this was the value. This resistor is actually present even at when it's used for FM purposes or FM audio purposes. But it's like maybe on the order of 20K, depending upon the deviation that you're working with. But then for the television purposes, they had like 150 ohm maybe or on that order to detect at 70 megahertz. Well, we used that in our first receivers, about our first 50. And I had an inspiration one day that reduced that to a ferrite bead, a single ferrite bead. And what we accomplished at that point was quite a bit more video output, much better linearity, and simplicity of construction.
Keith Anderson was the first to use the 430 to 930 megahertz band for block reception. He was, therefore, the first one to bring the cost of block-down conversion within reach of the average person. And this involved his use of the standard UHF television tuner with some clever Keith Anderson modifications as the heart of the satellite receiver. He is not so sure that the block receiver designers who favor the 950 to 1450 megahertz band have done the most intelligent thing.
I understand that the tuners are being built. Our tuners yes. being built to accommodate the 950 to 1450. But still, even at this time, 4 years later, they aren't building a wide range of cable type amplifiers or cable type devices. So I see nothing wrong with ours. We're operating the plant down there. We're within a half a mile of a UHF broadcast that's channel 14, right? It gives us no trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And so I see nothing wrong with using a frequency that is outside of our cable.
Mm-hmm.
There's another advantage. If you're bringing it any distance, of course, is the cost factor. You can use a cheaper cable. So I really don't see what all this excitement about 950 to 1450 is about.
One other thing I'd like to add to that, with probably over 25,000 ST-1000s out there, we have never had a single complaint of UHF television interference. It doesn't exist since we put the electronics in a metal housing and got that shielding.
So I think the real reason that some companies have leaned toward 950 is the fact that the image frequency is displaced further, even on C-band, of course. If you have an LNA, which is amplifying 2 gigahertz or 1500 megahertz, and are using 950 as your lowest IF, why 1950 megahertz below may be down quite a bit further than when you're using 460 for your lowest IF. And the reason that, so they can eliminate the necessity of filtering prior to the mixer, if they are in fact out of the passband of the LNA in the 950 range. But that filter doesn't...
What does that add to it?
It doesn't add 25 cents to the cost of your board.
Yeah.
So why not do it right rather than...
It doesn't add a nickel.
No, it doesn't. So.
This is Bob Cooper. Good evening from the studios of West Indies Video.
Next time, Bob will complete his visit with TVRO receiver innovator Keith Anderson, and we'll see firsthand the performance of the tiny TVRO receiver of the future. It will actually fit into your coat pocket and cost far less than any receiver available now. Pat Porter is next on Space Showtime, and he'll tell you what a train whistle triggers in his mind. Stay tuned.
In 1981, we set out to build a unique satellite TV magazine. For 5 years, we've covered all the important satellite news and now bring you over 8,000 hours of satellite viewing each week with the easiest-to-read grid format. If you own a dish, you need to know. And when you need to know, you need Channel Guide. Only $39 a year. Channel Guide, 800-654-3006. Call now for a free sample.
A new satellite technology is offering you a world of opportunity. Ku band or DBS makes possible the reception of satellite signals using a very small dish, perhaps as small as 18 inches. Now, Ku Band World magazine has been launched to introduce you to this exciting world of Ku band technology, perhaps one of the greatest profit opportunities of this century. Dr. Ed Meek, publisher of the highly regarded Satellite TV Opportunities magazine, is publishing Ku Band World.
Ku Band World magazine is the nation's first magazine devoted exclusively to Ku band technology. Ku is the wave of the future, offering many profitable opportunities in home entertainment and business applications.
Of the satellites being launched in the next decade, 15 are the standard C-band or large dish satellites, while 75 are Ku band small dish satellites. Ku Band World, your world of opportunity. Subscribe today. Call toll-free 1-800-922-2812. Ku Band World magazine, just $25 for 12 issues.
Good evening. How are you folks? I'm Pat Porter, Skeet and Leela's boy, here with my segment on Satellite Showtime, Inside Out. I have here a unique thing. It's patented. It has a picture of a train on it, and it's a whistle. And it makes a sound like a train whistle. And I picked it up, and I was really fascinated with it, in that someone took a block of wood and cut it just right and was able to make a whistle out of it. And sounds just like a train whistle. You know, when I hear a train whistle, I think it. Everybody knows something. A friend of mine had a scrap iron and metal yard in Snyder, Texas. At one time, the RS&PW, the Roscoe, Snyder, and Pacific Railroad, ran from Roscoe, Texas, 35 miles up north to Snyder, to hook the Santa Fe Railroad and the Missouri Pacific together in their transcontinental link. A little 35-mile railroad that did very well. One day the RS&PW had a derailment, and they wadded up a lot of railroad track. And my friend traded for the railroad track, and he'd bought it right. Now, one of the things that you need to realize is that in order to take scrap iron to the smelter, you have to cut it in 30-inch lengths. Now, railroad rail, just because of what it's made for, is extremely dense and very heavy and will dissipate heat. So he had guys out there with torches, and they were trying to cut it, and they were having no luck at all. They were wasting lots of time, lots of material, trying to cut that railroad rail and were not able to. He said a fella came up and he said, "Neighbor, would you like a friendly tip from a stranger?" He said, "I'll take a tip from anybody." And the guy said, "Let me show you something." Reached down, picked up a piece of a file, and marked that railroad rail, picked up a hammer, hit it, and it shattered right there at the mark, just like a piece of glass. Because railroad rail, even though it's dense, is very, very brittle. That's one of the reasons that you don't want to use railroad rail overhead, because it's not made for that. It's made to support a load. He told his friends, he said, his workers, he said, shut down those torches. Quit. Get yourself a piece of a file, get yourself a hammer. And they started then to make money because they were cutting that railroad rail in the proper lengths to take to the smelter and doing it in a cost-effective manner because they were working so fast. He turned to thank the fellow, and the fellow was gone. Not seen him before or since, did not know him from Adam's off ox. But he said, if I had were able to see the guy today, I'd put $2,500 right here in his front coat pocket because he made me several times that much money with that just that piece of information. You know, I have a letter here. As I said, we get letters. And in this could be a $100 million idea. This letter merely alludes to the fact that advertising on programming for CNN, for HBO, for Showtime, and so forth. You see, the jury's still out No one knows how to get what a person wants to see to the person who wants to see it and extract a fair price or compensation for that. See, there are several ways to pay for this. You can pay for it by pay for programming. You can pay for it by subscription. You can pay for it by supporting advertisers that advertise on that. So there is $100 million puzzle out there yet to be solved. All you have to do is come up with the idea, the thought, and the $100 million can be yours. And you have as good a shot at it as anybody else I'm talking to here tonight. Really, it's just you and I, because I'm the only one that's going to tell you about it. But do you realize what an opportunity there is here for someone? Network times $200,000 a minute for an advertising. Transponder time is $400 an hour. And you think there's not an opportunity? An opportunity that has never been equaled in our lifetime. There's a lot of different ways to do it, and we have the technology on hand to do most of it. So I want to tell you, everybody knows something. This fellow had a better idea. Maybe you could invent the better mousetrap. If you have an idea, why don't you share it with me? Pat Porter, Inside Out, Richland Center, Wisconsin. The zip is 53581. And I'll try to get back to you, and we'll discuss if your idea is better than any others that have come along. And I'll be glad to share with you, because there'll be plenty to go around. I appreciate your time and your trouble listening to me tonight, and it was my pleasure to come and visit with you. And I'll look for you next week on Inside Out with Pat Porter. Thank you.
Space Showtime has been brought to you by corporate sponsors Luxor North America, STV and OnSat Magazines, and Caltronics Incorporated. Next week, the show will be live from Washington, D.C., and you'll have a chance to call in and talk with your representatives from space. In case you ever miss Space Showtime on Tuesday nights, you can catch a rebroadcast of it Wednesday at 12 noon Eastern Time on SpaceNet 1, Channel 19. Remember, you'll catch this show live from Washington next week. See you then.